Most digital transmissions are encrypted and decrypted symmetrically, using a single shared key for both operations. But how do you share a key in the first place when eavesdroppers are lurking? Previously, we discussed one solution, namely, encrypt and transmit that key using an asymmetric public key protocol like RSA. RSA security stems from multiplication of two large primes being a one-way function. Easy to do, hard to reverse. Well, today, we'll explore a different one-way function that enables an altogether different and much cooler solution to the key sharing problem. Homework alert. You're gonna need these prior episodes to understand this one. So trust me, now is the time to pause and go watch those. In those episodes, we said that symmetric single key encryption schemes have become the workhorses of secure communication, and for a good reason. They're fast and practically bulletproof once two parties like Alice and Bob have a single shared key in hand. But that's the challenge. They can't use symmetric key encryption to share the original symmetric key. So how do they get started? Sharing the key offline is conceivable, but it's rarely practical or even possible. Instead, one of them could transmit a shared key after encrypting it asymmetrically using a public-private key protocol like the well-known RSA scheme. But no matter what, to get the ball rolling on symmetric encryption, Alice and Bob seem to need some mechanism of transmitting a shared key up front. But what if Alice and Bob could share a key without transmitting it? In other words, what if they could somehow synthesize keys separately that could somehow be guaranteed to come out identical? That sounds impossible, but it can be done via a procedure called Diffie-Hellman key exchange, named after the authors of the 1976 paper in which that proposal was first published. Diffie-Hellman, or DH for short, has several variants, but I'll focus on the original version just for easier exposition of the main ideas. However, some disclaimers. One, we're about to get more mathy, so I suggest following along with pencil and paper and pausing as necessary. Two, in the interest of time and clarity, I will oversimplify and gloss over many details. The references listed below should partially fill that gap, but let us know in the comments if you'd like more details fleshed out by us. And third, Diffie-Hellman is based on modular arithmetic. Now, Kelsey once gave a nice primer on this topic that I will rely on heavily. This episode is not self-contained. So if you need a refresher on that, it's time to pause me and go watch her. I'll wait. Welcome back. Diffie-Hellman is based on some neat structural properties of the numbers less than n that are also relatively prime or coprime to n. That was a mouthful. As Kelsey previously stated, every positive integer smaller than n and coprime to n has a mod n period, some smallest power r that gets you back to 1 after repeated mod n exponentiation. For example, suppose that n is 8, to which 1, 3, 5, and 7 are all coprime. 1 has a mod 8 period of 1, since 1 to the 1 is always 1. And some quick arithmetic shows that 3, 5, and 7 each have a mod 8 period of 2. How about when n equals 5? Well, since 5 is prime, all the positive integers below 5, that's 1 through 4, are coprime to 5. Again, 1 has a period of 1, and 4 has a period of 2. But notice that this time, 2 and 3 each have a mod 5 period of 4. Moreover, en route to a value of 1, the mod 5 powers of 2 and 3 each cycle through all the coprimes of 5. This cycling feature is the linchpin of Diffie-Hellman. And to talk about it concisely, I need to introduce some terminology. So bear with me for a minute, because we need this. The set of numbers coprime to n, together with mod n multiplication, is called the multiplicative group of integers mod n, which for this episode, I'll abbreviate to just the mod n group. By the way, group here doesn't just mean collection. It has a technical, mathematical meaning that we'll get into another time. Moving on. The number of elements in a group is called its order. Both the mod 8 and mod 5 groups have order 4. Elements of the group whose powers cycle through the whole group are called primitive roots mod n, or alternately, generators of the mod n group. So, 2 is a primitive root mod 5, aka a generator of the mod 5 group. Groups that have at least one generator are called cyclic. So the mod 5 group is cyclic, but the mod 8 group is not, because nothing in that group cycled. Just to make sure you're following, because that was a lot. go ahead and verify for yourself that the Mod 7 group is cyclic and that it has two generators, 3 and 5. By the way, if you're wondering which Mod N groups end up being cyclic and which ones don't, the cyclic ones have N equal to 2, 4, a power of an odd prime, or twice a power of an odd prime. That's a neat fact, not obvious. Anyway, with this terminology in hand, here finally is the Diffie-Hellman protocol. Step 1. In full view of Eve, Alice and Bob will agree on two things. First, a modulus N. This amounts just to choosing some multiplicative group. And second, they'll pick one of the generators G of that group. So say they pick N equals 11 for illustration. The group elements are 1 through 10, all co-prime to 11, four of which are also generators, 2, 6, 7, and 8. Let's say they pick G equals 7. Step 2. Alice and Bob each pick one number at random from the group that they won't reveal, even to each other. Let's say Alice picks A equals 2 and Bob picks B equals 4, arbitrarily. Step 3. Alice and Bob each compute G raised to the power of their own secret number mod N. And then they transmit those results to each other with Eve still watching. As you can see, Alice and Bob end up transmitting 5 and 3 respectively. And now, the magic. Step 4. Alice and Bob each raise the other's publicly transmitted number to the power of their own private number, mod N. And check it out. In mod 11 arithmetic, they both end up with 9. Now, why that happens seems less mysterious if you represent this last maneuver in terms of the generator G equals 7, and if you invoke the fact that exponent rules still hold in modular arithmetic. But conceptually, do you see what just happened? Alice and Bob have managed to share a number, 9, without ever transmitting it publicly. So they can now use that number for symmetric encryption, provided that Eve can't also determine that number from those numbers that she has intercepted. So can Eve do this? Can Eve guess Alice and Bob's shared number? In our simple example, yes, but in general, no. And even our simple example can give you insight into why. Think about it like this. If you were Eve, how would you solve these equations to find Alice's or Bob's private number? You'd probably end up listing the mod 11 powers of 7 and seeing where 5 and 3 fall in that list. Now, even with numbers this small, I think you can see that that's much slower and less procedural than what Alice and Bob have to do to synthesize the 9 in the first place, namely just raise 7 to a single power. More generally, when the modulus and the exponents are enormous, computers can still do modular exponentiation extremely quickly, but there simply is no fast way to undo modular exponentiation. That inverse problem is called the discrete logarithm problem, or the DLP, and it's much harder than the ordinary logs you do on your calculator. There are better algorithms than just listing powers of the generator, but even those rely on pre-computing some sort of lookup tables. And here's the thing. Eve's best known method for discovering Alice and Bob's shared key is to solve the DLP for at least one of their secret numbers. Now, when N is 11, Eve can make the necessary tables by hand, but if N is a huge prime, Eve's in trouble. That's not because prime numbers are inherently necessary for Diffie-Hellman, but rather because from a practical standpoint, a group with a prime modulus N will automatically have N minus 1 members, which is also a huge number. That means a crazy number of generators and powers of generators to tabulate. Once N has several hundred decimal digits, then cracking the DLP becomes computationally infeasible within a human lifetime, even for the NSA. So there you have it. That's my admittedly oversimplified, but still fairly faithful synopsis of Diffie-Hellman key exchange. It's a good reminder that, contrary to much popular belief, encryption is not inherently about primes or factoring, but rather about one-way functions. And here's a fun fact. One-way functions needn't be numerical in nature. In fact, in a later episode, we'll showcase the one-way function with the fastest growing footprint in contemporary cryptography, a one-way function whose flavor is much more geometric. You're super curious now, huh? Patience, Grasshopper. We will get there. I'll see you soon. Hey guys, we are 3 episodes now into our cryptography series, and you all had a lot to say about our first 2 episodes on symmetric and asymmetric encryption. First, let's address the elephant in the room, which is pacing. Sebastian Elytron asked if Gabe always speaks this fast. Bob C. had a good response, said, no, this is decaf Gabe. Ray Fangrui did him one better and said, no, it's more like Ambien Gabe. I'm not married to one pacing or another. Nobody's forcing me or Ty to speak at any pace. We're just trying different things out to see how the audience responds to it. But interestingly, Juan T did point out that after listening to anyone at a fast pace for a while, you kind of start to get used to it. You learn to listen faster. Electronic Feelings pointed out that the sun is not actually going to explode and that I should know better than that. We should have caught it in the graphic. And that's true, but when we started typing, the sun will go into a red giant phase and eventually collapse into a white dwarf, we kind of ran out of screen space. So, on a more substantive note, on our first episode, DMessage1981 pointed out that not any old shuffling and scrambling scheme will do, that the one chosen for AES has some provable security features, and that's correct. Back around 2000, NIST held an open competition to determine what protocol would actually be adopted as the advanced encryption standard. And the one that won was one that had some good features, but several of the runners-up are also very good and still in use. For example, Twofish. It's just that AES, the one that was actually adopted, happens to be the most ubiquitous. Yevheny Diamandov asked what key exchange would look like in a world with time travel. I don't know anything about that, but he pointed us to a paper on the archive that seems to talk about this stuff, just not as a theoretical actual possibility about physics, but just as a toy model to explore some aspects of cryptography. It looks like it's, you know, a perfectly real paper. So if you look below, you should see in his comment the link, the archive link to that paper. Check it out if it's something you're interested in. Luna Langton and Sophias Orange both pointed out that YouTube does use RSA upfront to authenticate itself via its SSL certificate. That's true, and I didn't mean to suggest otherwise. But to keep these videos manageable, I've been trying to focus on the encryption per se that happens in an encryption exchange, and not on the rest, not on the other layers of a cryptographic suite. And one of those layers is authentication, and sometimes, yeah, that happens via an RSA public key exchange behind the scenes. But the actual encryption of the stream in YouTube handles symmetrically after some variant of the Diffie-Hellman key exchange protocol that you just heard about happens up front. And speaking of Diffie-Hellman, Spikehead777 and Ludverks somewhat presciently both pointed out, oh, Computerphile just stole your punchline by doing Diffie-Hellman. So we filmed our Diffie-Hellman episode before Computerphile's went up. You should check out Computerphile's episodes. They did a very nice job. We ended up covering some territory that they didn't, and their presentation involved some non-mathematical analogies that we opted not to use. And that's how things should be on YouTube. You want to hear, particularly with tough material, presentations coming from lots of different angles and different people and different people's takes on stuff, because that's how you get increasingly familiar with and get increasingly able to wrap your head around difficult stuff. Yug or Yug Chauhan or Chauhan, don't know how to pronounce it, he asked whether Kelsey would ever come back and hang out on PBS Infinite Series. And she's absolutely always welcome, but as DMessage1981 pointed out correctly, she has to finish her PhD dissertation. And that's no small feat, and she's not exactly swimming in free time right now. Finally, Lostaris asked if Bob from our videos is also the guy who used to do science friction. Come on, Lostaris. It's only in comic books and movies that the guy who used to do science friction would end up directing and producing the math and physics shows for PBS Digital Studios, right?
Or is it?